And welcome to The Walk. Last week, we talked about the kings and what the expectation was for a king in Israel. The king was to be the mind, the heart, the strength, the soul of the nation. And the king was to connect God and the people. So now, let's look how some of the kings measured up to this standard. I'd like to begin with Saul. The story actually begins with Kish, who is Saul's father. Kish lost all his donkeys. Donkeys were transport animals, and it would be probably similar to a car dealer losing all his cars one night. It was a very big financial loss. It was an emergency for the family. Kish sent Saul, his son, and his servant to go fetch these donkeys, and off they went. They were devastated. This was a horrible thing that hit the family. They lost everything, and this was a bad day, a really bad day. And they were really panicked over the loss of these donkeys, as you can imagine. Saul and the servant, they can't find the donkeys. The servant says, hey, there's a man of God, the prophet Samuel. Let's go talk to him. And so when he comes up to Samuel, his life has changed. Samuel tells him how he is going to be the leader, and he stays with Samuel overnight, and they have the feast to the Lord. The thing that's really interesting is they were having the worst day ever. This is tragic. Our family is ruined. They were having this kind of day. But behind the scenes, God was working to make them a royal family, to make Saul a king. And this was very important to remember for us now, because some days we think we're devastated. This is the end of life as we know it. We've lost everything. We're in ruin. But the truth is, behind the scenes, God is doing something. So all is well. The donkeys are all found, and Samuel tells Saul, you are the chosen one. And Saul says, but, you know, I'm from an insignificant family, and we are from the smallest tribe, and it can't be me to be leader over Israel. And Samuel says, it's you. Samuel anoints him in secret, which is interesting. And then when Saul goes home, he doesn't even tell his family. He was a very humble, humble person. He was very meek. He had the heart of a servant. In fact, the first time we hear of him, he is acting as a servant alongside a servant, working to find the missing donkeys. It's him and the servant together. He's not too proud to go and do the servant's work because he has a meek heart. And this is God's leadership that he has chosen as a king of Israel, is to be servant leadership. Are the people ready for that when they ask for the king like other nations? No, this was not what they had planned on. So they drew lots, and it came down to, you know, Kish's family, and the last lot drawn said it was going to be Saul. So now it was legitimately, in front of the people, chosen to be Saul. And Samuel says, see, you wanted a king. This is the king that you have chosen. So then he says, let me present to you your king. And they were waiting to see who this king was, and they couldn't find him. Where is Saul, son of Kish? Where is he? He was hiding. They're expecting the big, strong warrior king to come in and the applause would just fall upon him. But where was he? No, he was hiding behind the equipment, it says. God had to say, go look behind the equipment. That's where he's hiding. He was not the lion-hearted king that they wanted. But he was who God chose. He was crowned king, and they chanted, long live the king. So apparently they did that back then too in 1 Samuel 10, 25. But there were some doubters, as you can imagine. They said, nah, this guy is not gonna lead us. He cannot lead us against the Ammonite king. So we're not gonna respect him. We're not gonna give him due what is a king, and we're just gonna reject him. And they did. But it wasn't everyone. So then the Spirit of God came upon him and made him angry. Now we think the Spirit of God today is something that calms us down. Like if we see someone really angry and the Spirit of God comes upon them, they soften up, right? Not so here, because he was already softened up. So the Spirit of God came upon Saul, and he became angry, and he gathered people together. He became fierce, and they went up against the Ammonites. And with the hand of God, of course, the Ammonites were defeated. And very importantly, he told them, God has defeated them. He never said, I defeated them. He said, God defeated them. This restored confidence in him. The people gathered together. And so he was crowned again. However, they came up to him and said, you know, all those people that didn't support you, those scoundrels and doubters that refused to pay any kind of homage to you, they should now be put to death. And he said, no. No one's dying today because God gave you the victory. He had been rejected. Why? The Benjamites were like the tribe from the other side of the tracks. People didn't like the Benjamites. In fact, there was a time when no one would even marry. They didn't have enough women, and people wouldn't marry a Benjamite. And so the Benjamites would kidnap women in the vineyard and drag the women off to be their wives because no one in their right mind would marry them. So this is the tribe he came from. They were kind of that tribe. So here he was, meek and mild, and he's from Benjamin, this tribe. And then hiding behind the luggage or the equipment when they're trying to crown him king, it just went all against him. However, this is the man God chose. This was the man who had the heart of a servant, the servant leadership that God really wanted for his kingdom, because he said, I will do the miracles through someone who is not so full of themselves, you know? This was the right one. And we look at Saul's life and we go, oh, it was a big mess. How did God pick him in the first place? It wasn't always that way. God chose the perfect guy for the role of servant king. The problem was people didn't want a servant king. They wanted this warrior king. And so what happened was they were trying to hammer the square peg into the round hole. They were trying to make Saul into something he wasn't. And sadly, he started buying into that as well. Later on, we see the people chanting, saying, Saul kills his thousands and David his 10,000s. And it became this vain competition. Before, remember what Saul said on the first victory against the Ammonites. It's not me who defeated, it was God who defeated the enemy. All of a sudden, it's not God who's the big hero. It's between me and David and whoever else. Because pride was in there. People had kept holding him up to be this warrior king, and he bought into it at the very peril of not only his kingship, but the nation. So instead of commissioning David, he competed with him. And in his heart, where there was once meekness, there became this dark, fearful paranoia. See, God's strength is made perfect in our weakness when we're connected to God. But when we're not, then our weakness is just our weakness. Sadly, Saul did some very specific things that caused a very pronounced spiral downward in his kingship. And the first one was he decided to take the place of Samuel in offering a sacrifice. Misplaced faith was his downfall, because the meek heart that was having faith in God was now replaced. People were looking at him saying, be like these other nations and all these strong kings. And he started to look at himself that way, and God floated out of the picture, like I just said about who was getting the credit for the victory. It wasn't God anymore. Number two, Saul did not kill the Amalekites. Now, Israel was always plagued by these Amalekites who were out to eradicate them. The Messiah, the Savior of the universe, was to come through the line of Israel. And Satan knows it, so he's always against Israel. And he was using the Amalekites to do it. And the Amalekites were a constant threat to Israel. So God tells Saul, you have to kill the Amalekites. So he didn't, and he came back with the king of the Amalekites alive, and he had the livestock and everything, and here he comes marching back, and Sammy goes, "What's this?" And he says, "Oh, I'll save the animals for the sacrifice, you know," and this is his excuse. And Samuel says, "Obedience is more important than sacrifice. And rebellion is as bad as sorcery." Which is pretty ironic that he said that, considering number three, the next thing that Saul did to really cut himself off from God was visit the sorceress, the witch of Endor. And so he visits a witch to try and summon Samuel to ask for answers. He is a desperate, desperate man. And it's a very dark ending to what could have been a beautiful kingship. I think one of the saddest things that Saul says in 1 Samuel 15, verse 30, Samuel didn't want to go with him, and he said, "Come with me so that I can worship your God." How come he's not my God or our God? "It's your God," he says to Samuel. He's rejected God as much as God's rejected him. In 1 Samuel 15:35, it says that God repented of making Saul a king. This word, if not examined properly, can misrepresent the character of God. Our God is infallible. He doesn't make mistakes or have regrets. The word in Hebrew, once again, remember, the Bible's written in Hebrew, not English. So once again, we go for the word that we have as repent or regret, and it's nacham. Now, interesting enough, the word for repent is actually shuva or teshuva, and that means to turn. You know, so you're doing something bad, you repent, you turn and do something good, and that's repent, teshuva. This repent is nacham, which doesn't mean that kind of repentance. It means a change of mind. Not like I change my mind, because in 1 Samuel 15:29 it says God cannot change his mind, he's not a human. However, God's mindset is in a mood changes. If you go to a wedding and you're rejoicing and you're happy, and you know, on your way home you see a terrible tragedy, your mindset changes. You go from rejoicing to grief. And that's what nacham is. It's a change. It just means God is walking alongside Saul in his kingship. And when he is close to Saul, God is happy. When Saul pushes him away, God is sad. And that is a change of mindset or of mood, to go from happy to sad. And that is what nacham is. It's that kind of transition. It's not a, "I regret what I did." So let's go back to our model, where we have the king is supposed to be the link between God and the people in Israel. Remember, we went over this last week. And now let's look at Saul. Where did he fit in this? Did he maintain his link with the God, and did he maintain his link with the people? Saul's story is a very sad one. He broke his link with God, but also the people he was trying to please so much, the people who tried to turn him into this warrior king, ultimately failed by him as well, because he did not have his trust in God. So let that inspire us to always keep our trust in God, and to remember, being meek and lonely is okay when we have our hearts tuned into God. His strength will come through our weakness. For Israel, however, this was the end of God saying, "I'm going to use servant leadership for this nation." It didn't work. God said, "Now you want a warrior king? You're going to get a warrior king." David was a warrior king, and the people suffered for that as well. But we'll find that out next week. Take care and see you then.